I greet you all in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Welcome here to this service of the Deo Gloria Baptist Church. Friends, I'm going to ask you if you've got your Bibles with you to turn with me to Colossians, the third chapter, and we are going to look at a few things there in Colossians chapter 3. It starts in verse 1. It says, if then, now if you look at the New Living Translation and also the NIV, it says, since then you were raised with Christ. Since then you were raised with Christ. Now that you are raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. And then he says this wonderful word. He says, for you died. Past tense, you died. So far, he has mentioned two things here. He said, you died. Now, you died and you were raised up with him. These two things. And now, friends, can I just tell you one thing? There is nothing that you can do to bring this to pass. Jesus died 2,000 years ago, and he was raised from the dead 2,000 years ago on the third day, and he is now sitting at the right hand of the Father. It is a completed job. It was done once and for all. He does not say, listen here, be good, do good things, do this, do that, do the next one, and then maybe you will be raised up with Christ. No, this is a once and for all transaction. Friends, Jesus died and he rose again from the dead. And when you and I receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior and we are born again, the Greek word there literally says born from above, then it means that we died with Christ. Past tense. It's in the past. We died with him. And there's nothing. There's one big thing that the devil will so much like to do. And that is to get you and me in that position where we've got to earn something. We've got to do something so that the Lord will bless us or that the Lord will do something for us. My dear friends, you know what faith is? Faith is taking into possession the things that Christ has already done for you. He has done it all from beginning to the end. He is the Alpha and he's also the Omega. And it was that great Prince of Preachers, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, that said, if you have made Jesus your Alpha, make sure that you also make him your Omega. So first of all, we can see here that we died with him. Now, whether you a good Christian or not a so good Christian, whether you a Christian like the ones in Corinthians that Paul wrote to and says, I cannot speak to you as to mature Christians, I'm speaking to you as babies, as Christians in the flesh. Now, whether you're in the flesh, whether you're a spiritual Christian, whether you're big or whether you're small or whether you're male or whether you're female, my dear friends, it does not matter. If you are born again, you have died with Christ. And if you have died with Christ, you were also raised with him unto a new life. He says, for you died, and listen to these words, your life is hidden with Christ in God. All these things so far are facts. It's a legal transaction. This is what has happened. My life is hidden with Christ in God. Whether I'm a good Christian or not, my life is hidden with Christ in God. But if I am really born again, my dear friends, you will, even if you are in the flesh, you will not stay in the flesh. And then it says here, when Christ, who is our life, Christ is our life, the life that I now live. Paul says to the Corinthians, I live by faith in the Son of God. Then when Christ, who is our life, appears, when he is revealed, when he is made visible, then you also will appear with him in glory. You see, my dear friends, the fact is that when Jesus comes back to this earth, he's going to bring with him all those who have died in Christ, all those down through the ages who were believers in our Lord Jesus Christ. They are coming with him back to the earth. And those who are still alive on the earth will meet him in the air. That's what we call the rapture. And so we will forever be with the Lord. So we will forever be with the Lord whenever he appears, whenever the second coming, whenever it's the second coming and the Lord is revealed, my dear friends, he will bring back with him your late grandmother who died in the Lord, your uncle, your aunt, your brother, your sister, your mother, your father, your friend, all those who died in Christ, the Lord will bring with him. Now, these four things are facts. It does not say here, listen here, you must tithe and get baptized and win 50 souls to the Lord every month to qualify for this. You have already qualified for that. Jesus has qualified you. He has qualified you. But what I actually want to deal with us together with these things is that he says here, after he told them to lay down their members that are still on earth, he says, because these four things, because they're the truth, because these four things are applicable to you and to me, he says, therefore, lay down all these things. But look at verse 12. He says, therefore, and whenever there's a therefore, you must ask why it's therefore. He says, therefore, as the elect of God, my dear friends, this word elect is literally a word that says that he has picked out. He has picked out of all the masses of people, he has picked out his children. Now, I know that there's such a big hullabaloo theologically and doctrinally because of this, but my dear friends, we cannot escape the fact that the Bible says that Jesus has elected us. Well, actually, the Father has elected us in Christ Jesus. When the Lord was on earth, he said, nobody can come to me unless the Father has drawn him. And then he says, all that the Father has given to me will come to me. My dear friends, the fact that you and I are born again is not because you love the Lord, because the Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Now, I think we must just, you know, some churches have gone overboard with the whole thing of election, and then it's, yeah, but what about those who are not elected? And they made a big theological thing of it. Other churches, again, because they don't want to hear from this, because it does not fit into their theological system, has completely scrapped it. But let me tell you, my dear friends, whatever we believe or don't believe, the Bible says here, therefore, as the elect of God, my dear friend, I want to tell you, if you want to progress in your spiritual life, accept the fact today that I have been chosen by God. It's not just by chance that you're a child of God. It's not just that you know, it was just by accident it happened. You see, a chain is as strong as its weakest link. If you take a chain and there's one weak link in that chain, it's going to break there where the weak link is. And my dear friends, some people say, yeah, but it's your own free will. Well, I want to tell you something. a man's own free will is very fickle. Fickle, fickle, fickle. I have married many couples in my life, and they stand there in front of the pulpit, and you say, will you take this man as your lawful wedded husband or lawful wedded wife? You ask the husband, they go, oh, yes, we do. We do. Some of them can't even wait to say yes. A couple of years later, they say, no, we don't. And another year or two later, they say, we never did. You see, man's will is fickle. You start on Monday morning with an absolute plan of starting to diet, and here by 11 o'clock somebody gives you a packet of biltong with nice yellow fat on, and suddenly your will changes like that immediately. You see, man's will is fickle, my dear friend, but God says, I have chosen you. And you know what he says in Romans 11, chapter 29? He never changes his mind about those to whom he gives his gifts and sends his call. He never changes his mind. He says, you love me because I have loved you. And Paul says, he writes to Timothy, and he says, Timothy, I give my life over to gather the elect. Now, friends, the elect receive Jesus, and if you receive Jesus, you're part of the elect. Let's not break out. We will one day understand everything, but one day, one thing I do know, the Lord does not want you to doubt the fact that he has chosen you and that he will not go back on his word. That's why national Israel is such an example to us, that even unto this day, my dear friend, even unto this day, even though they turned their backs on the Lord, and even though they said, we've got one king and that is Caesar, and even though they said, we don't want anybody else, let his blood come upon our children, upon us and our children, my dear friends, God is still faithful to them. He says, if you unfaithful, I will remain faithful. We live in a day of uncertainty. Everything is uncertain. My dear friends, I have last week lost four people, I'm in the middle, this is a week of funerals. And I just want to tell you, my dear friends, that death is around us. You can lose your life any moment. And you know what, my friend? If your salvation is also in doubt, oh, what miserable, miserable people we are. God does not want you to doubt the fact that he has chosen you. You say, but why has he chosen me? You will never know, because God says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. There was nothing good in you and me. We were all of us born in sin. There's nothing good in any one of us that have made God choose us. He has chosen us. And he says, as the elect of God, holy. My dear friends, when he chose us, he made us holy. You are holy. The Bible says in Hebrews 10, verse 10 and 14, he says, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. For by one offering he has perfected forever. You've been perfected forever, my dear friends. He has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. In other words, my dear friends, you have been made holy. Now you can say, but oh, you can't say I'm holy. You know, I still did something wrong yesterday, and I swore at the taxi that swerved in front of me, or I was cross with somebody, or you did whatever you did that was not right. But my dear friends, you've been made holy. It is as if somebody have deposited 20 million rand into your bank account. Just think of it. And what happens now is that you already have the 20 million. The person didn't come and say, listen, here's a list of 15 things. If you do these things and you don't do the next 21 things, then I will deposit 20 million rand into your bank account. No, he said, I have deposited the 20 million rand into your bank account. Now live as a billionaire or as a multimillionaire or as a dollar millionaire. Live now like that. You can now, you know, you must make use of the money that you've got in the bank. The fact that I am holy, that I've been made holy, we call this positional sanctification. My dear friend, we will never progress in our life of sanctification if we don't understand this. Never. Because then we try and do it ourselves. We try and please God out of the flesh, and that cannot happen. But I must remember that He has made me holy. And what Paul is writing to the Colossians, he says, clothe yourselves with this new person, this new man. You must show yourselves, put off all these things, and then clothe yourself with this new man. Put on the new man who is renewed of knowledge. We must put on the new man, and part of this new man functions on the basis of God has chosen me, God has made me holy, and thirdly, he says, as the elect of God, holy and beloved. Holy and beloved. My dear friends, can you understand it? That when Jesus was on earth, the Bible says that he loved his disciples, and those whom he loved unto the end. He does not change his mind. He's not a man that he should lie. He's not like men that say today, those people when the Lord was crucified, the one day they sang Hosanna to the King, and 3 days later they shouted, crucify him. God is not like that. Those whom he loved, he will love until the end. And my dear friends, it's so important that you and I realize Jesus has chosen me. Jesus has sanctified me, has made me holy. Although it might not still look like it, although it's not, you know, yet, you're not yet where you should be, by far not. But you are in the process, those who are being sanctified. And thirdly, Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. He loves me, and he will love me to the end. Does not matter what COVID is doing. Does not matter how the political situation looks like. Does not matter what is going on in the world. But Jesus has chosen me, he has sanctified me, and he loves me, and he will do it right until I breathe my last breath here on earth. The Lord bless you. Have a wonderful week. Everything that's good and pure and lovely.